part two on Monk. It was just getting a little long, so I wanted to wrap it up and put the second part on its own little episode. So we've discussed Monk, Blue Note, Prestige, Riverside, the three great New York jazz labels, and Monk's comeback from Europe in 61, a fairly successful tour over abroad, and a fairly big career change as the wedding as he comes home. He's managed to sign to Columbia Records, just like Miles had a few years before. And signing to Columbia Records is going to be huge for any musician, because you go from being a name that's popular in jazz circles, that's going to be known in New York and jazz communities around the country are going to know you, being Blue Note, Riverside, Prestige. But going to Columbia puts you on a national stage. And I've talked about that many times. So being on a national stage is going to allow you to make more money, have far more exposure, be popular in far wider range of places. But it's also going to give you a great studio setting to record in. Not that the smaller labels weren't giving him great recordings, but once they go to Columbia, there's also a certain amount of course changing that takes place. And Monk makes some great records for Columbia. And Monk's always going to be Monk because he really can't help himself. But I still think that his Columbia output is a little safer, a little straighter, a little more... we can't use that take, Monk. That was too weird. I don't want to speak out of turn. I wasn't there. But you don't get a lot of the difficult, bizarre Monk once you get here to Columbia. This is far more straightforward. And his popularity skyrockets. And a guy that was fairly undervalued in the early years of his career, and almost an unwanted entity, by this time is becoming a household name. And Monk is probably right behind Miles and Coltrane in terms of a name that even a non-jazz cat has probably heard the name Thelonious Monk. It's a hard name to forget once you've heard it. And you might not remember the Thelonious Monk when someone asks you, but when someone says Thelonious Monk, you've probably heard that before. And again, that's in part to the power of Columbia. This is the Crisscross record, a second effort on Columbia. It's got Charlie Rouse, Frankie Dunlop on the drums, and John Orr on the bass. This is his third album on Columbia, Big Band and Quartet. And if I recall, the Big Band on here is probably 8 or 9 pieces. Again, which I've said before, isn't my favorite setting for Monk. But by the same token, Ellington often uses a huge orchestra and then uses a quartet for some pieces. So it's not that shocking that a guy directly in the Ellington Basie lineage in some ways would at times want to flesh out larger pieces. Yeah, it's a huge group. Eddie Burt, Butch Warren, Phil Woods, Charlie Rouse, Steve Lacy, Thad Jones, Nick Travis. And then the quartet is just the Monk, Rouse, Warren, Dunlop stuff. But, it's cool that Columbia gives him the budget and the time frame to really tinker with different lineups, different groups. This is a record where one side's dedicated to Miles' group, and the other side is dedicated to Monk's group at the time. And it's weird that Monk has PB Russell playing with him. But again, it's just the power of Columbia is making Monk very much a household name. It's Monk's Time. It's another cool Columbia record. Number 2184. So we're probably talking about 1964 at this point. Maybe 65. And there's some Monk right there. That's Monkey. Monk is that. You know what I mean? It's... It's weird how eloquent the right hand is being and how block choppy the right hand is being. Again, we got Rouse on the sax. Rouse is with them a long time. Butch Warren and Ben Riley. Probably Charlie Rouse of all the horn players sticks with Monk the longest. But before Rouse plays with Monk, Rouse is doing the Les Mode stuff with Charlie, with Julius Watkins. And a lot of that Les Mode stuff was pretty intricately arranged, a lot of composition. So I think playing with Monk for Rouse was stimulating. He's like, oh yeah, this is fun. This is a pretty famous record on Columbia. Probably 64 again. He's redoing Panonica. April in Paris is great on here. I don't see the group here, but Bill Evans actually writes some of the liner notes here. Make no mistake, this man knows exactly what he's doing in a theoretical way. Organized, more than likely in a personal terminology, but strongly organized nevertheless. We can be further grateful for combining aptitude, insight, drive, compassion, fantasy, and whatever else makes the total artist. So Bill Evans, who's a concurrent contemporary of Monk, is just lauding it. And it'd be foolish to not recognize that Monk is influencing everybody. If Bill Evans and Coltrane are having their careers arc modified by Monk, who wasn't? If there's a player that's tougher to change the track he's on than Coltrane, I don't know who he is, but Monk redrew his train tracks. This is a cool record, Solo Monk. Never been crazy about that cover, but I think part of your compromise at Columbia, some of the album covers are going to be a little bit less than desirable. Columbia's capable of making some great album covers, but I don't think their sensibilities were very in tune to jazz very often in terms of how album covers were going to look. Mysterioso, of course, there's a record on Riverside of the same name, but this was Charlie Rouse, Larry Gales, and Ben Riley. This is from probably the 65 or 64 tour, produced by Teo Macero. But this is a fun record, and it gives you a little insight into where Monk is in the late 60s. Monk is also, like Ellington, a guy who composed a lot of songs that became standards. And while the average jazz playbook isn't filled with Monk songs like Will Be Ellington songs, there's a number of songs by Monk that are fairly omnipresent. And Straight No Chaser is one of them. You're probably not going to play this at every function if you're a little jazz group, but you're certainly going to play this with your group when you're rehearsing. And he's just a guy that is so often imitated that it gets lost where the imitation comes from. You know, so we need to hold Monk in the highest of esteem. This was Underground, Thelonious Monk, and I think this is a bit of a collection of stuff. I'm not sure on this one. We're getting a little bit later in the Columbia discography, probably late 60s. There's a Monk Greatest Hits. A record people have told me they're not crazy about is this Monk's Blues record. And I have mixed feelings on this one. I had it in my car for a while. Some days I would love it. Other days I'm like, okay, no, I don't want to hear this right now. But Oliver Nelson, huh? I forgot Nelson was a part of this. That explains some of the passages that I found a little confusing at times. But again, I mentioned Nelson in episode one. Nelson's a guy that clearly heard Monk and was influenced by Monk. I like the version of Straight No Chaser on here, of course. Brilliant Corners has a redo on here. That's interesting. And then lastly, Thelonious Monk, Who's Afraid of Big Band Monk. This is stuff taken from some of the albums that had the bigger bands in it. So that wraps up his Columbia years. And one of the true greats and giants of this music is Thelonious Monk. And we don't always appreciate the giants like we should. You know, I think there's guys in jazz like Miles and Coltrane who get so much praise heaped on them. But in the grand overarching scheme, when you see a lot of the timelines, Parker, Monk, Armstrong, Ellington are the four grand architects of the pyramids. And I think anyone who really wants to understand jazz, if you start to understand those four players, get to know what Armstrong was about, understand Ellington and the developments and changes he brought, hear Parker and the fire and the virtuosity at tempo, and then hear how Monk channels all of that and distills it down into that weird but successfully accessible tonic. And I think that's the essence. And jazz from the 20s up to 1970 has the fingerprints of those four all over it. And I don't think there's a whole lot of jazz recorded at any point after those four innovators' careers happens where the fingerprints of those guys that came before them aren't present in that music. If you're playing jazz in the late 60s, there's going to be echoes of Ellington, Parker, Monk, and Armstrong in whatever you do. And as much as you might be trying to defy that and step outside the guidelines and break the rules, you're still going to have to acknowledge and go through the gates and the doorways that those four create. And Miles is in no way in the pantheon of those four. Coltrane for me would be the fifth member of the Mount Rushmore for me, but there's only four on the mountain, so we got to keep him out. So it's just my opinion, but what I have a fairly comprehensive collection of jazz, obviously, especially the 50s and 60s, and I know my pre-war swing era fairly well. And as a musician myself, and hearing other musicians speak about it, and watching the videos and reading and listening to the music, you realize that the innovation these men all made crossed every chapter of the music after they made it. And I can't hear jazz in the 1960s and not hear Ellington and Armstrong and Parker and Monk. So we all have to tip a hat to those four guys. I would strongly recommend to everybody who's in the jazz, get to know those four guys. Get to know those principal players. Those guys who changed the music for everyone after them. Because it will inform you on every other player, and even your ear at some point will be able to tell, oh, this guy is obviously post-Parker. This guy is obviously after Monk. Oh, this guy obviously heard Ellington. And they all do. They all do. And even Ornette Coleman, in order to kind of change some of the rules, had to know the rule makers. So I appreciate you all for watching. Hope you all stay safe out there. We're going to keep making episodes here as long as we can. Appreciate you all. Stay subscribed. Tell your friends about it. Share this stuff on your Facebook if you want. Let people know about the Jazz Shepherd. He appreciates you all. Y'all be safe. Peace. Hey guys, how you doing today? I'm gonna put a little Serge Chow off in the background. I believe he's from Boston area. He does a number of records with Al Cone, Four Brothers Cats on Vic and RCA. He's a great sax player. This is a little 10-inch on the Storyville label. He's got a couple things on Capitol that are definitely worth finding. But today I'm going to do a little quick episode on my jazz binders. They're two different sets of discographies. One covers an artist discography, and it's a series of those alphabetically. And then the other one covers the record labels, their sequential release orders. And this is the binder I have now for the jazz artists. And this started out as a series of 30, 40 pages of artists I really liked, was into, had a number of records by. And when I went to a record store, I wanted to be sure if I needed something or not. I hated that feeling of being there going, fuck, do I have this? And what really coupled with that to make that more pressing was once I started buying records online about 10 years ago, you spend enough time bidding on a record on eBay and you lose it two or three times. You see it in the wild, unlike that record you've never seen before and you know you don't have it, suddenly you've spent a lot of time chasing this record and you're like, did I win this last time or not? And sometimes, of course, you know I didn't get this, but other times you're like, sometimes you see something too much, it becomes so familiar that you're like, did I get that one or did I get the, you know what I mean? It's just, so I wanted to have that clarity. And so I just, I went to Wikipedia, found the artists I was talking about, the Lee Morgans, the Hank Mobleys, just guys I was into a lot, Kenny Dorhams, Jimmy Smith, all down that line. A lot of them were Blue Note guys, some of them were Verve Cats, some Impulse guys, and you start looking for the heading that says discography, artist discography, and then you go to that, and you can have the option of doing just their albums as a leader, or their albums as a sideman too, which I started to do with the sidemen as well eventually, and I started printing out all the different artists that I was really into, that I was like, okay, I might as well just look for their stuff and know if I don't have it, buy it when I see it. And so it starts off as a stack of loose, printed, just sheets of paper that I kept in a little bag and carried with me to record stores. And as my collection grew over the last 5 years, I started adding more and more artists to it. And eventually the paper bag, the plastic bag they were in, got so messed up and the paper was starting to get really ruffled that I'm like, you know what? I just need to punch holes in these and put them into a binder. And they're somewhat color-coded, but I kind of went away from that eventually. But like, you'll see Art Farmer there. And whatever's highlighted, of course, I have. And I always wanted to get the first half dozen art releases by the artists I'm into, and then covered in the late 50s into the mid 60s, and then if I really like them, I'll get stuff further. Like I have Burrell records into the 80s, but so you'll see there's Farmer stuff with the Jazz 10 on Argo and the Bink there, and then here's a bunch of his stuff he does as a sideman. And this is a real educational tool. You really start to learn a lot of the details that I kind of know from having these printouts. You're like, oh shit, I forgot that he played with this guy on that record. And it's just alphabetized. There's Maynard Ferguson with the 7 records I have of his, some of his side work. Tommy Flanagan, I only got 3 records of him as a leader, but I got a ton of his stuff as a side guy. And so you actually even kind of learn which artists spent most of their career as sidemen. Like Paul Chambers has hundreds of records as a sideman and very few as a leader. It's Coltrane, of course. His discography is massive. Same with Miles Davis. I have 70 records by both those guys. But it just was a real educational cross-reference tool. So here's Paul Chambers. I got 8 albums of his by a leader. And then we start to see all the different side work starting right there. And then Page. It's like Chambers is on so many great records from that era. And this binder's actually starting to fall apart a little bit itself now, sadly. But just the rings are getting a little loose. But as you can see now, there's probably 200 artists in this one. And I probably don't give an artist a sheet in here unless I have 5 records by them, maybe 3 or 4. If I'm starting to really get into them, I know I'm going to buy more. But if you have 1 or 2 records, I don't really ever add you in here. It's when I start having 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 35, 42, 67, that's when you're going to get a sheet. And you slowly really start to learn a lot of the time frames, cross-referencing, even the labels, because it'll give you that information. So that's binder number 1. Binder number 2 came about shortly after I made this one, because there's a lot of cool records that you're not going to get a ton of records by that artist. And there's a lot of label stuff where you just want to have an understanding of that label. And even with labels, sometimes you get a record, you look at it like, oh, I've seen that a lot. Do I have that? And this is what helped me sort out a lot of that in discrepancies. I start with the ABC label. And some of these labels I had to go to a different site than Wikipedia to find. Here's Argo. And you can see Argo, I have pretty much everything in the first couple hundred records. There's a few titles missing, and then it starts to thin out. And then I actually added the Chess label here recently, because I did that Chess documentary, and I have quite a few Chess records. Then we jump to Atlantic, and we see how the 1200 series starts, and then the 1200 series kind of continues. 1300, there's a bunch of great assists there, which I don't got, but most of what's missing in this one, and a lot of these labels are going to be compilations, greatest hits packages, you know, and you can find the ones you don't want, and slowly as you start to fill in these labels, usually you start with the guys you know, and like, oh, I need to have that, I like that guy, and then you start to discover more and more artists you've never heard of, but you're like, oh, that's a decent price for that, it's number 1327, I don't have it, I'm going to grab it. And you start to really learn the label history that way. And I documented in pencil as each of these sequences grew, so I kind of would know where I was with a certain artist. Here's Bethlehem. There's the 10-inch series right there by Bethlehem, which I completed. And that's going to give way to the Bethlehem BCP series, which is also completed 1 through 81. And then it goes to the 6000 series, which you'll also see is completed. Then of course it jumps to Blue Note, which has the 10-inch series on the front, which I've been kind of working on. And then the 1500, which of course, complete, 4000, complete. So this is kind of how I did it. There's Candid, there's Contemporary, and like I said, there's CTI. That's Emercy, you know, page after page of Emercy, Fantasy label. There's Impulse, page after page after page after page. I think we jump to Jubilee Records now. And then Pacific, I think, is at the back end of that one. And you can see even like a label like Pacific, the first 100, I'm pretty much close to having a lot of that stuff. Then we get to Prestige, and I have the 7,000, 7,71, 7,200 series is complete. I'm probably about 65 into the 7,300 series, and then 74, 75, 76. I got dozens of titles in each one of those sequences, plus Moonsville, Swingsville, and New Jazz. All adds up to over 500 Prestige records. It's a pretty amazing discography that Prestige has. And of course, we got Riverside, which is complete. At least the 200, 300, 400 Jazzland series. Actually, there's a few of those New Orleans revival records I haven't picked up. And then it goes to a little history on Savoy. As you know, this is Roost. And I did the Roost printouts. And I have most of the Roost label. And then, of course, it jumps to Savoy. And I have the majority of the early Savoy stuff. And then, of course, it's VJ. And then it goes to Verve. And Verve, I have most of the late stuff. And I'm probably about halfway now into getting the early Norm Grant stuff. And then Columbia was a tough one to find, because Columbia is not all just jazz either. So that was a tougher one to do. But these printouts were great shopping guides, and they're super informative. They're super educational, and it's not tough to do. All you got to do is every week or so, print off a half dozen artists of jazz that you really like, punch holes in them, put them in a binder, and then highlight the record you have by them, and bring that with you when you go into a store. And it'll even tell you what time frame our record's from. Was it a greatest hits? Is this a repackaging? There's so many different reasons why these came in handy. A lot of Prestige records will have three different covers. And if I find something 7,400, like, oh, I don't got this, and I'll look at it in my book, and it'll say 7,426, a re-release of 7,016. I'm like, oh, I don't need this. I have it. I have the first version of it. And so I've always tried to get the earliest version of things. And like I said, the LPR started in 54, 55. Most of these labels, LP era, is where I started to document my jazz collection from at a certain point. And as I got deeper into it, I'm like, okay, so much of the jazz canon that I love kind of mirrors the dawning of the LP era. And all these labels that came into existence, some of them predate the LP era, but they were putting that stuff all into LP when that era dawned. And so filling in the discographies of these great jazz labels from 54, 55 up until about 65, 67, getting all those early titles especially, it really starts to inform you on who's cutting edge, who's leading the pack, who's kind of following, who's taking it safe, who's recording black artists. All that insight, all that stuff I share, so much of it just comes from having these discographies and learning them and collecting them and buying them all and using these printouts as a guide. Wikipedia will have most of the artists. Wikipedia will have most of the labels you're going to want to collect. And there's a few other sites you can go to for some of the labels that are a little tougher to find, because Wikipedia is not always complete with certain things. But they've been very instrumental in what I've learned and how I've approached sharing jazz, learning jazz, and buying jazz. And I can't tell you how many times it's come in handy when I've been in a record store, find a pile of things I want, to be able to flip through these books and have a guide to go, okay, yeah, I need this. No, I don't need that. Oh, this is something that's really late. And when I go to Chicago or New York for record buying, I remember going into Reckless once and finding just a ton of stuff. And I had to call my wife to come back with the van to drop my books off, because I needed to whittle this pile like this down to like this. And it's probably still dropped $300 at that one location, probably another $300 at the other location. But again, it helps you discover the sequence, the serial codes. If the number on the record, say Prestige 7,065, you're like, okay, that tells me this is early in the sequence, probably 1956 or 7. And so it just gives you a lot of little cross-reference points to help you understand And sometimes you'll find a record that was an import, has a totally different sequence number on it. You might want to avoid that copy because you want the real sequence number. I don't care about that stuff as much, sometimes depending on the record. But there's a lot to be gleaned from these printouts. And it will kind of help you go to that next level as a collector, both in buying, shopping, and in your comprehension. Because in the doing this, and the highlighting of it, and the looking at it, and the referencing it, and the filling it in, all that stuff is going to teach you, inform you, and educate you every time you do it. Every time I go through these books, there's always an, oh, fuck, I forgot he played on this guy's record. Oh, shit, I didn't remember that he was on this label for that brief moment. Oh, shoot, this guy's a Riverside guy, but he's a sideman here on a whole bunch of prestige records. So there's a ton of gleaning and comprehension you can grasp from doing these printouts. A lot of people have asked me about my books, because I mention them from time to time, so I figured I'd cover them as succinctly as I can, and anybody can do it. You don't need to be asking me how to do it. You just go to Wikipedia and do some printouts, and you add to it slowly, and next thing you know, you have a nice little compendium of the jazz artists you love. And then, like I said, if you want to get to that next level, start collecting the labels, there's a lot that you can learn from that. So hope you all dug that. I appreciate you watching. I got a cool episode coming on Thelonious Monk soon. Y'all be safe. Peace.